Chapter 20. Tree diyoruz. Acaba diyorum her seferinde böyle şu kafamı düzeltip geliyor. Acaba diyorum her seferinde böyle farklı bir ses tonuyla mı Chapter 23 falan yapsam olur. Çok iyi ışık oluyor. Ben normal devam edeyim en iyisi. Christmas on the Closed World diyor. İlginç bir bölüm adı. Tam olarak neyi kastediyor Closed World derken? Grimmauld'dan mı bahsediyor falan? It seems. Was this why Dumbledore will no longer meet Harry's eyes? Did he expect to see Voldemort staring out of them afraid, perhaps? Did their vivid green might turn suddenly to scarlet with cat-like slits for pupils? And he remembered how the snake-like face of Voldemort had once forced itself out of the back of Professor Quirrell's head. And he ran his hand over the back of his own, wondering what it would feel like if Voldemort burst out of his skull. Bu bir kere en basından şeye geliyor. Cidden order bir şeyleri size söylemiyorsa falan bir sebebi var falan. Uçak bir şey duydu, ne uğradığını şaşırdı falan. İşte anlatabiliyor muyum? He felt dirty, contaminated as though he were carrying some deadly germ. Germ ne demek bilmiyorum ama büyük ihtimal aslında söyledikleri haklı, Voldemort'un ruhunun parçasını taşıyor çünkü kendisi. I'm worthy to see on the underground train back from the hospital with innocent, clean people whose minds and bodies were free of the taint of Voldemort. Ne kadar anlamlı değil mi? Şu an söylediği her şey doğru ama aslında yanlış. He had not merely seen the snake, he had been the snake, he knew it now. And then a truly terrible thought occurred to him, a memory bobbing to the surface of his mind, one that made his insides writhe and squirm like serpents. Aklına yılanlarla ilgili bir şey geldiğini anlıyoruz. Was he after a part from followers, stuff he can only get by stealth, like a weapon, something he didn't have last time. His body, I'm the weapon, he thought, and it was as though poison were pumping through his veins, chilling him, bringing him out in a sweat, as he swayed with the train through the dark tunnel. I'm the one Voldemort's trying to use. That's why they've got guards around me everywhere I go. It's not for my protection. It's for other people's, only it's not working. They can't have someone on me all the time at Hogwarts. I did attack Mr. Weasley last night. It was me. Bu D vurgu yaptılar da şey mi oldu? Normalim mi döndü gibi olmuş? İnanamadım. Neden bu D vurgusu da diğer vurgu devam ediyor anlayamadım. I did attack Mr. Weasley last night. It was me. Voldemort made me do it, and he could be inside me, listening to my thoughts right now. Are you alright, Harry dear? Whispered Mrs. Weasley, leaning across Ginny to speak to him as the train rattled along through its dark tunnel. You don't look very well. Are you feeling sick? They were all watching him. He shook his head violently and stared up at an advertisement for home insurance. Harry dear, are you sure you're all right? Said Mrs. Weasley in a worried voice. They walked around an unkempt patch of grass in the middle of Grimmauld Place. You look ever so pale. Are you sure you slept this morning? You go upstairs to bed right now, and you can have a couple of hours of sleep before dinner, right? He nodded. Here was a ready-made excuse not to talk to any of the others, which was precisely what he wanted. So when she opened the front door, he proceeded straight past the troll's leg umbrella stand and up the stairs and hurried into his and Ron's bedroom. Here he began to pace up and down past the two beds and Phineas Nigelius's empty portrait, his brain teeming and seething with questions and ever more dreadful ideas. Tabii bu Phineas Nigelius portresi orada olduğu için paso Harry'den haberi oluyor falan. Bak, bir nokta daha açıldı şu an. Hangi nokta açıldı? Ne kadar çok portreniz varsa o kadar çok bilgi edinmiş, o kadar çok bilgi sahibi bir insan olmuş oluyorsunuz. Bütün portrelerin sahibi kim? Dumbledore. Hogwarts'ın sahibi olan kişi ne oluyor? Dumbledore gibi oluyor. Doğru şartlar altında. Hani Amos Diphet falan of course Dumbledore gibi değil ama şeyi görüyorsunuz değil mi bağlantıyı? Dumbledore oluyor bir yandan. Çünkü bir yandan kullanabileceği o kadar çok portresi, cartı cürtü var ki böyle falan. Yani en basitinden şimdi şeyi Dumbledore gayet öğrenebiliyor rahat bir şekilde. Hani Grimmauld Place'te ne konuşuluyor? Harry ne düşünüyor? Hermione ne düşünüyor? Ron ne düşünüyor? Nasıl davranıyor falan. Hani düpedüz bu Phineas, Nigelius böyle şey oluyor. Köstebeklik mi denir? Köstebeklik ediyor Dumbledore'u falan. Ben iddiasına giriyorum, bu böyle sıkılmış falan gibi konuşuyor falan bir yandan. Böyle Harry oradaydı dedi ya, böyle uyanmıyormuş falan gibi davranıyor ama bir yandan da cayır cayır rapor veriyordur, yani rapor diyorum, rapor veriyordur Dumbledore, işte turuncu saçlı Ron dedikleri oğlan şöyle davranıyor, şöyle düşünüyor, Harry şöyle düşünüyor falan. Öyle. Şimdi Gryffindor Common Room'da portreler var mı falan anlatıyor ama şey var, Fat Lady var. Fat Lady bir sürü şey anlatıyor olabilir Dumbledore'a falan yine. Bir şekilde ev cinleri var yine. Dumbledore'un o kadar çok şeyi var ki şöyle bir düşününce. Uygulayacağı taktik diyeyim. Harry, Ron'u, Hermione'yi duymak, tanımak, onları anlamak için. Sanırsız sayısız yani. Sanırsız sayısız dedim. Sınırsız sayısız yani. Aynen. Ama lafı uzatmayayım, diyecek burada pek bir şeyim yok. Herhalde bir durayım 2 saniye, ne olur ne olmaz. Continue then. His brain teeming and sitting with questions and ever more dreadful ideas. How had he become a snake? Perhaps he was an animagus. No, he couldn't be. He would know. Perhaps Voldemort was an animagus. Yes, thought Harry. That would fit. He would turn into a snake, of course. And when he's possessing me, then we both transform. This still doesn't explain how come I got to London and back to my bed in the space of about 5 minutes, though. But then Voldemort is about the most powerful wizard in the world, apart from Dumbledore. It's probably no problem at all to him to transport people like that. And then with a terrible step of panic, he thought, but this is insane. If Voldemort's possessing me, I'm giving him a clear view into the headquarters of the Order of the Phoenix right now. He'll know who is in the order and where Sirius is. And I've heard lots of stuff I shouldn't have. Everything Sirius told me the first night I was here. There was only one thing for it. He would have to leave Grimmauld Place straight away. He would spend Christmas at Hogwarts without the others, which would keep them safe over the holidays at least. But no, that wouldn't do. There were still plenty of people at Hogwarts to maim and injure. What if it was Seamus, Dean or Neville next time? Şimdi aynı olayları Slivers'ın esnasında, tam da bu herkes onun Slytherin varisi olduğu düşündüğü zamanlar yaşamış olsaydı uşak, neler neler hissedecekti, yaşayacaktı falan değil mi? Şöyle önceki kitaplara refer edebildiğimizi görünce olayların leşliği konusunda daha da leş bile olabilirdi önceki kitaplardan. Şu kitabın şu sahnesinde, şu kısımlarında o an gerçekleşiyor olsaydı gibisinden falan. Ne kadar böyle zor şeyler yaşamış bir uşak olduğunu anlıyoruz. Of course. He stopped his pacing and stood staring at Phineas Nigelius's empty frame. A leaden sensation was settling in the pit of his stomach. He had no alternative. He was going to have to return to Privet Drive, cut himself off from other wizards entirely. Well, if he had to do it, he thought there was no point hanging around, trying with all his might not to think how the Dursleys were going to react when they found him on their doorstep 6 months earlier than they had expected. He strolled over to his trunk, slammed the lid shut and locked it, then glanced around automatically for Hedwig before remembering that she was still at Hogwarts. Well, her cage would be one less thing to carry. He seized one end of his trunk and had dragged it halfway toward the door when a sneaky voice said, "Running away, are we?" He looked around. Phineas Nigelius, bu karakteri hiç bu kadar sevdiğimi bilmiyordum. Şu an çok seviyorum. Çok sevdiğimi fark ettim. Had appeared upon the canvas of his portrait and was leaning against the frame, watching Harry with an amused expression on his face. Not running away, no, said Harry shortly, dragging his trunk a few more feet across the room. I thought, said Phineas Nigelius, stroking his pointed beard, that to belong in Gryffindor House you were supposed to be brave. It looks to me as though you would have been better off in my own house. The Slytherins are brave, yes, but not stupid. For instance, given the choice, we will always choose to save our own necks. It is not my own neck I'm saving, said Harry tersely. Tugging ters, yani böyle ters bir şekilde falan, yani Türkçesinde de şeyi var ya böyle. O bağlantı çok güzel. Belki de aslında aynı yerden geliyor olabilirler. That's a good topic. Topik mi? Artık başka bir şey mi? Özlü, kısa bir özlü, vicil özlü. Ha, ters bir şekilde. Ben şey olduğunu zannediyorum. Uyuz uyuz konuşmak gibi böyle ters yapmak falan. Türkçe ile aynı anlama geliyor. Acaba dedim Türkçe'deki hal İngilizcesinden mi geldi falan gibi düşündüydüm. Teori finished. İşe yaramadı. It's not my own neck I'm saving, said Harry. Tersely, tersely, tugging the trunk over a patch of particularly uneven, moth-eaten carpet right in front of the door. Oh, I see, said Phineas Nigel, who was still stroking his beard. This is no cowardly flight. You are being noble. Öyle bir şekilde söyledi ki sanki aslında başından beri Harry'nin ne yapmaya çalıştığını biliyormuş, ona kaçmak, ondan kaçmak diye bahsediyormuş falan. Sırf buna bu zihniyeti, bu akıl yürütme yapısını Harry de kapabilsin diye "This is no cowardly flight. You are being noble," diye cowardly flight ile noble'un arasındaki farkı düşünerek benim tam olarak neyi kastettiğimi anla, bul, uşak etti Harry'ye. Harry ignored him. His hand was on the doorknob when Phineas Nigel said lazily, "I have a message for you from Albus Dumbledore." Harry spun around. Burayı ufak tefek hatırlıyorum ama tam da hatırlamıyorum, onun içinde bir heyecan geldi hafif. "What is it? Stay where you are." "I haven't moved," said Harry, his hand still upon the doorknob. "So what's the message?" "I have just given it to you, Dol," said Phineas Nigel smoothly. "Dumbledore says, stay where you are." "Why?" said Harry eagerly, dropping the end of his trunk. "Why does he want me to stay? What else did he say?" "Nothing whatsoever," said Phineas Nigellius, raising a thin black eyebrow as though he found Harry impertinent. Ay, tam durduracaktım aslında, şey için durduracaktım. Bir fikrimi söyleyecektim. Durdursaydım fikrimi söylediğim zaman boşuna gitmiş olacaktı. Allah korudu. Tamam. Ben kendimi durdurdum. Okumuyorum. Ve konuşuyoruz. Dumbledore nasıl anladı Harry'nin şeyleri duyduğunu mu diye, Mrs. Weasley falan, ya da direkt onu mu anladı, başka bir şey mi anladı bilmiyoruz. Birden böyle şey oldu ve Harry'e stay where you are edecek kadar şey oldu. Şimdi ihtimal bir, Mrs. Weasley falan işkillendi böyle bayağı bir. Nope, öyle değil. Düşün. Şey olabilir, bir şekilde Harry hikayesini anlattığı zaman dürüst, doğru bir şekilde anlattı falan. Tamam. Bir Accusatory Luke olayı vardı ama Sirius'un evinde oldu. Ondan olmuş olamaz. Dumbledore nasıl anladı Harry'nin burada şey olduğunu? Bu olayı çözmemiz şart. Oğlum şart nasıl anladı? Yani Extendable Ears'la dinledi bir 4-5 kişi falan. Dumbledore yoktu orada. Portreler vardı daha ki. Aneyin olay bu mu yoksa? Ama yok. Bir şekilde onlar duydular ama konuşmadılar birbirleriyle. Harry seni Voldemort ele geçiriyormuş şu an, etmedi yani. Ben bir şekilde Harry'i izletip duruyor. Mundungus izliyordu Harry'i yine. Belki de tam böyle yine şey varken ortada. Diyeceğim ama Moody ile şey vardı. Tonks vardı. Gerçi. Moody ile Tonks hani şey olabilir. Sırf Harry böyle izlenmiyorum hissine sahip olsun diye şu an beni açık açık izliyorlar diye Dumbledore tarafından kasıtlı bir şekilde yerleştirilmiş iki insan olup aslında Harry'i gerçekten izleyen üçüncü bir insan Mundungus gibi böyle hiçbir şekilde Harry'e gözükmeden falan dolaşıyor olabilir ve o an şey etmiştir falan, bu olabilir. Dumbledore nasıl anladı daha ki bunu yani? Aklıma şu an bir şey gelmiyor. Gelirse konuşacağız. "Nothing whatsoever," said Phineas Nigellius, raising a thin black eyebrow as though he found Harry impertinent. Harry's temper rose to the surface like a snake rearing from long grass. Bu snake benzetmeleri gelip durdu falan. Aa, niye? Niye böyle yılan benzetmesi yapıp durmaya başladı yazar? Bir tane de serpent gördük daha demin. Böyle şey mi diyor? Bizimle mi oyun oynuyor şu an yazar bir şekilde? Bir yandan da o Snape laflarını, Snape diyorum, Snake. Snape'in de Snake'le bir harfin farkı olması neyse. Snake laflarını kullanıp şey mi ediyor böyle? Evet, Harry cidden, Voldemort cidden Harry'i ele geçirdiği için artık yılanlar vasıtasıyla düşünüyor, ediyor, cırt falan. Ama şey değil ilginç, yani o kadar bariz bir hortkuluk göndermesiymiş ki resmen, iki tane yılanın gölgesinin çıkması, ikisi işte özünde ağzı değil mi falan diye Dumbledore'un böyle kendi kendine konuşması falan. Kendi kendine konuştuğu yerin ikisi aslında özünde birbirlerinden farklı öyle mi falan olması. Dumbledore'un ikisinde yılan olduğu halde falan. Hani Harry'nin duyacağını bilerek o konuşmayı yapması falan. Of, bunlar çok şey noktalar. Derin mi? Derin ya. Bunlar derin noktalar hani. Ben ne diyordum, ne düşünüyordum? Ha, neden bu Snake like falan? Like a snake reading from long grass. Çünkü Harry'nin kafasının bir tarafı da aslında cidden yılanlarla çalışıyor falan. Bu ama birden başladı. Hani o kadar birden başladı ki bu bütün bu yılan benzetmeleri falan şey olduk hani. Bence birden başlamasının şeyi Harry'nin birden paranoya olduğunun ve kendini aslında canavarmış, tehlikeliymiş bir şey gibi görmesinin düşünce işleyişine de yansıması. Onun sonucunda her şeyi yılan vasıtasıyla görüyor falan. Her şeyi yılan vasıtasıyla görüyorum. Voldemort beni ele geçiriyor falan. Şey böyle, iyice paranoyak oldu uşak. Bu bence güzel bir cevaptı. Güzel bir tahmin. Buna şimdilik tutunuyorum. Hoşuma gitti. İyi açıklıyor birçok şeyi. Devam ediyoruz lan. He was exhausted, he was confused beyond measure. He had experienced terror, relief, and then terror again in the last 12 hours. And still Dumbledore did not want to talk to him. So that's it, isn't it? So that's it, isn't it? He said loudly. Stay there. That's all anyone could tell me after I got attacked by those dementors too. Just stay put while the grown-ups are the dog, Harry. We won't bother telling you anything though, because your tiny little brain might not be able to cope with it. You know, said Phineas, Nigellius even more loudly than Harry. This is precisely why I looted being a teacher. Young people are so infernally convinced that they're absolutely right about everything. Has it not occurred to you, my poor puffed up popinjay, that there might be an excellent reason why the headmaster of Hogwarts is not confiding every tiny details of his plans to you? Have you never paused while feeling hard done by to know that following Dumbledore's orders has never yet led you into harm? No. No, like all young people, you are quite sure that you alone feel and think, you alone recognize danger, you alone are the only one clever enough to realize what the Dark Lord may be planning. He is planning something to do with me then, said Harry swiftly. Did I say that, said Phineas Nigellius, idly examining his sick clothes. Now, if you will excuse me, I have better things to do than to listen to adolescent agonizing. Good day to you. And he strolled into his frame and out of sight. Fine, go then, Harry, below that empty frame and tell Dumbledore thanks for nothing. The empty canvas remained silent. Fuming, he dragged his trunk back to the foot of his bed, then threw himself face down upon the moth-eaten covers, his eyes shut, his body heavy and aching. He felt he had journeyed miles and miles. It seemed impossible that less than 24 hours ago, Cho Chang had been approaching him under the mistletoe. He was so tired, he was scared to sleep, yet he did not know how long he could fight it. Dumbledore had told him to stay. That must mean he was allowed to sleep, but he was scared. What if it happened again? He was sinking into shadows. It was as though a few minutes had been waiting to start. He was walking down the deserted corridor toward the plain black door. Resmen daha çok yoruldu, daha kolay bir şekilde teslim oldu falan. Bunlar da önemli noktalar. Basit ama önemli. Pass rough stone walls, torches and an open doorway onto a flight of stone steps leading downstairs on the left. He reached the black door but could not open it. He stood gazing at it, desperate for entry. Something he wanted with all his heart lay beyond. A prize beyond his dreams. If only his scar would stop prickling, then he would be able to think more clearly. Here is Ron's voice from far, far away. Mom says dinner is ready, but she'll save you something if you want to stay in bed. He opened his eyes, but Ron had already left the room. He doesn't want to be on his own with me, Harry thought. Not after what he heard Moody say. He supposed none of them would want him there anymore now that they knew what was inside him. On dediklerin hepsi doğru ama yanlış. Doğru ama yanlış falan. He will not go down to dinner. Bu da güzel bir olay. Yani bu kadar büyük bir hata yapıyor Harry. Hani bir şekilde şu hatanın oluşu resmen aslında doğru cevap gibi bir yandan. Hani böyle Voldemort çocuğu ele geçiriyor dedi. Harry içinde Voldemort'un bir parçası varmış gibi konuşmaya başladı. Hani olay bu zaten. Hani bu kitabın sonuna doğru bunun aslında doğru olmadığını anlayacağız falan. Ama bir yandan aslında Harry anladıydı falan. Bir şekilde başından beri biliyordu ama o kadar yanlış bir şekilde böyle doğru bir şekilde şeyi anladı ki diyeyim hani şey olacak. Hani biz bu kitaptaki aslında Harry yanılıyormuşumsu hisse geldikten sonra büyük ihtimal istemsiz beynimizin çok uzak köşelerini itmiş olacağız zaten. Onun için 7. kitapta Snape'in anılarına bakarken Harry'nin de aslında Horcrux olduğunu öğrenince olacağız böyle. Çünkü böyle çok öte yaptıydık anlatabiliyor muyum? Böyle şok olacağız falan. Çok çok başarılı. Ben hiç bunu böyle fark etmediydim hani. Şimdi daha iyi anlıyorum hani. Öyle. Bayağı başarılı yani. Düpedüz taktik. Lockdown bütün okurlar düşüyor taktiğin içine. Bir çukursa böyle çukur ağzına kadar dolu şu an. Öyle. Devam de. He will not go down to dinner. He will not inflict his company upon them. He turned over onto his other side. And after a while dropped back off to sleep. Waking much later in the early hours of the morning, with his insides aching with hunger, and Ron snoring in the next bed. Squinting around the room, he saw the dark outline of Phineas Nigellius standing again in his portrait, and it occurred to Harry that Dumbledore had probably set Phineas Nigellius to watch over him in case he attacked somebody else. The feeling of being unclean intensified. He half wished he had not obeyed Dumbledore and stayed. If this was how life was going to be in Grimmauld Place from now on, maybe he would be better off in Privet Drive after all. Everybody else spent the following morning putting up Christmas decorations. He could not remember Sirius ever being in such a good mood. He was actually singing carols, apparently delighted that he was to have company over Christmas. Harry could hear his voice echoing up through the floor in the cold and empty drawing room where he was sitting alone, watching the sky outside the windows growing whiter, threatening snow. Aşırı böyle umuda girdim ve çok mutlu oldum şu an. All the time feeling a savage pleasure that he was giving the others the opportunity to keep talking about him, as they were bound to be doing. When he heard Mrs. Weasley calling his name softly up the stairs around lunchtime, he retreated farther upstairs and ignored her. It was around 6 o'clock in the evening that the doorbell rang and Mrs. Black started screaming again. Assuming that Mundungus or some other order member had come to call, he merrily settled himself more comfortably against the wall of Buckbeak, the hippogriff, wall of Buckbeak, the hippogriff's room where he was hiding. Trying to ignore how hungry he felt as he fed Buckbeak dead rats. It came as a slight shock when somebody hammered hard on the door a few minutes later. I know you're in there, said Hermione's voice. Will you please come out? I want to talk to you. Tam şey gibi değil mi? Hagrid, hani böyle Hagrid tam komik değil ama komik bir yandan. Hagrid'i bağırıp çağırıyorlardı. Umurumuzda değil senin annenin dev olması falan. Tam aynı hesap şu an Harry oluyor. Blur'un okuması çok sarıyor. Devam. Devam. Çok sarıyor demeye gerek yok. Siz hissediyorsunuz zaten benim ne kadar severek okuduğumu falan. Devam. What are you doing here? Harry asked her, pulling up open the door as Buckbeak resumed his scratching at the straw-strewn floor for any fragments of thread he might have dropped. I thought you were skiing with your mom and dad. Well, to tell the truth, skiing is not really my thing, said Hermione, so I've come for Christmas. There was snow in her hair and her face was pink with cold. But don't tell Ron that. I told him it's really good because he kept laughing so much. Anyway, mom and dad are a bit disappointed, but I told them that everyone who's serious about the exam is staying at Hogwarts to study. They want me to do well, they'll understand. Anyway, she said briskly, let's go to your bedroom. Ron's mom's lit a fire in there and she sent up sandwiches. Ha bir dakika, şöyle bir olay da var. Hermione o şey duymadıydı. Uzayan kulaklardan duydukları şey falan. Aslında Hermione'nin bir şekilde şu an tam bilmiyor oluyor. Direkt yaşayanlardan değil falan. Çok önemli değil ama birden aklıma geldi hani bu nokta. Devam. Let's go to your bedroom, Ron's mom's lit a fire in there and she sent up sandwiches. He followed her back to the second floor. When he entered the bedroom, he was rather surprised to see both Ron and Ginny waiting for them, sitting on Ron's bed. I came on the night bus, said Hermione eerily, pulling off her jacket before Harry had time to speak. Dumbledore told me what had happened first thing this morning, but I had to wait for the term to end officially before setting off. Ha. And it is already livid that you lot disappeared right under her nose, even though Dumbledore told her Mr. Weasley was in Settemungos, and he'd given you all permission to visit. So she sat down next to Ginny, and the two girls and Ron looked up at Harry. How are you feeling? Asked Hermione. Fine, said Harry stiffly. Oh, don't lie, Harry, she said impatiently. Ron and Ginny say you've been hiding from everyone since you got back from Settemungos. They do they? Said Harry, glaring at Ron and Ginny. Ron looked down at his feet, but Ginny seemed quite unabashed. Well, you have, she said, and you won't look at any of us. It's you lot who won't look at me, said Harry angrily. Maybe you're taking it in turns to look and keep missing each other, suggested Hermione, the corners of her mouth too itchy. Very funny, snapped Harry, turning away. Bayağı eğlenceliymiş. Oh, stop feeling all misunderstood, said Hermione sharply. Look, the others have told me what you overheard last night on the extendable ears. Yeah, growled Harry, his hands deep in his pockets as he watched the snow now falling thickly outside. All been talking about me, have you? Well, I'm getting used to it. We wanted to talk to you, Harry said, Ginny, but as you've been hiding ever since we got back. I didn't want anyone to talk to me, said Harry, who was feeling more and more nettled. Well, that was a bit stupid of you, said Ginny angrily, seeing as you don't know anyone but me who is being possessed by you know who, and I can tell you how it feels. Well, that was a bit stupid of you, said Ginny angrily, seeing as you don't know anyone but me who's been possessed by you know who, and I can tell you how it feels. He remained quite still as the impact of these words hit him. Then he turned on the spot to face her. I forgot, he said. Lucky you, said Ginny coolly. I'm sorry, Harry said, and he meant it. So do you think I'm being possessed then? Well, can you remember everything you've been doing, Ginny asked? Are there big blank periods where you don't know what you've been up to? He racked his brains. No, he said. Evet, tamam, şöyle bir iyice düşünüyor dediği gibi no yapıyor. Then you know who hasn't ever possessed you, said Ginny simply. When he did it to me, I couldn't remember what I'd been doing for hours at a time. I find myself somewhere and not know how I got there. He hardly dared believe her, yet his heart was lightening almost in spite of himself. Şimdi burası of course göründüğünden çok daha önemli eğer size çok bir şey görünmüyorsa gibi. Çünkü 6. kitapta ilerleyen olaylar neticesinde Harry Ginny'ye baya aşık olacak falan ve bunlar böyle sevgili falan da olacaklar. Bir şekilde bunun için hani kitapları baştan sona okumuş insanlar ve kitapları çok seven insanlar olarak birden böyle hani Ginny'nin Cho Chang'den sonra başlayacağını biliyoruz. Onun için böyle Ginny'ye dair 5. kitaptan başlayaraktan diyeyim. Bütün böyle şeyi topluyor. Zaten başından beri topluyoruz. İlk kitabından tut 7. kitabına kadar. Olay şu, ne diye hani Ginny ile Harry oldular, tamam mı? Ne diye olabildiler falan. Ne diye bu kadar dengesizken yani bir taraf çok seviyorken diğer taraf hiçbir şey hissetmiyorken birden iki taraf da birbirini kabul edecek kadar denk bir seviyeye gelebildiler falan. Yani olaylardan biri şu, bir kere Harry bu kadar geriliyorken bu Voldemort ona eli geçirme şeyinden falan düpedüz Ginny geçirdi falan hani öyle ya da böyle. Bir kere aşırı şey hissetti burada. Ya bir şekilde hiç kimsenin ona yapamayacağı tam olarak bir şeyi Ginny yapabildi şu lafla. Hani şunu şeyden başkası söyleyemezdi zaten cinden başkası. Bu bir. Tamam düşün Abdullah. Düşün Abdullah. Neyse bir şekilde hani şu lafı söyleyebilmesi o daha deminki cinin gösterdiğim yeri cinin onu söyleyebilmesi falan Harry'nin böyle kalbindeki tüycüklerden birini oynatıveriyor yerinde. Ve Ginny'ye olan aşkımız ürüyor. Tamam mı? Altıncı kitaba doğru böyle art arta falan. Hani bir şekilde olay bu mu yani? Hani yazarın olayı, yani olayı dediğim dünyayı anlaması ve ifade etmesi böyle mi? Hani bir şekilde bir insan öyle bir yere dokunabilecek ki böyle bizde hani şey olduğunu anlayacağız. Oraya dokunabilen birinin var olabildiğini mi anlıyor olacağız? Olay bu mu hani falan? Bir şekilde bize sadece bir kişinin, sadece böyle özel bir kişinin söyleyebileceği bir lafı mı duyacağız birinden falan hani? Ben mesela şeyi merak ediyordum hani. İşte böyle bir şekilde hani öyle bir durum olacak ki o an böyle söylemediğimiz etmediğimiz bir şeyi bir insan kasıtlı bir şekilde söylemediğimiz etmediğimizi anlayıp böyle bizi takdir edebilecek falan. Ben bunu böyle senelerdir şeydim, tamam mı? Hiçbir şekilde yaşamadıydım falan. Hani o kadar çok yeri gelen ince veriyordum. O kadar çok incelerimi kimse kapmıyordu ki falan. Ben böyle şey oldum. Hani böyle biraz kitapların, filmlerin olayı gerçek hayatta böyle olmuyor falan gibi düşünüyordum falan. Ama geçen işte böyle bir şey dedim. Daha doğrusu bir şey demedim bir konu hakkında. Hani özellikle demedim çünkü böyle şey etmek de istemedim, bilmiyorum. Söylemek istemedim hani diyeyim kısaca. Neyse ablam fark etti, tamam mı? Ha dedi işte Abdullah da hiçbir şey demiyor falan. Halbuki onun bir şey diyeceği vardı falan etti böyle. Hani böyle bu şu an ses tonundan anlattığım şeyden veremedim ama az önce bayağı şey bandı böyle. Ben böyle şok oldum. Böyle çünkü resmen birisi referansımı alabildi falan gibi bir şey oldu. Senelerdir kimse almadı. Bak bir Allah'ın kulu hatırlamıyor. Neyse böyle bayağı bir şey oldum, etkilendim falan. Tabii ki hani alakası yok. Şimdi buradaki Cin'in, Harry'nin o kalbindeki ince tüye dokunabilmesi falan devasa bir şey benim dedim o ana kıyasla. Ama hani böyle o kadar açmışım ki böyle bu tarz bir şey yaşamaya falan ve bayağı bir şok oldum falan. Aşırı hoşuma gitti falan zaten. Neyse. Şimdi şey diyorum hani olay bu mu? Bir şekilde öyle birisi öyle bir laf edecek ki öyle bir referansımızı kapayabiliyor olacak ki falan. Birden biz şey olacağız. O kişi bizi tavlamış olacak tabiri caizse. Yani bu yazarın kendi hayatını deneyimledi. Kendi hayatını süzgecinden geçirip bir kitap yazdığı zaman o kitapta bu işin nasıl olduğu. Böyle. İnce noktaya dokunma. Hani buna niye bu kadar önem veriyorum? Hani herkesin farklı fikri oluyor burada. Game of Thrones'ta çok fazla şeyi göreceğiz mesela. Hani böyle bir female, bir tane male verelimizde. Bu ikisi birbirlerine o kadar böyle uyuyorlar ki hangisi female'dı, hangisi male'dı ikisi de farkına varmıyor falan. Mesela bir şekilde bence George R. R. Martin'in anlaması diyeyim bu işi. İki böyle iki tarafın birbirlerini tamamlayıcı, resmen aşk diyeceğimiz bir seviyede ilişkinin gerçekleşmesi. İki tarafın kendi cinsiyetlerini unutması. George R. R. Martin'de böyle bu. Sanki Yüzüklerin Efendisi'nde Tolkien'de böyle şey, imkansız aşka rağmen, imkansız olmasına rağmen iki tarafın da ya böyle birlikteliği kabul etmesi falan. Ne oldu? Aragorn'la şey, Arwen mesela, Arwen ölümsüzdü. Böyle ölümlülüğü seçebildi sırf şey için. Aragorn'la birlikte olabilmek için falan. Bu herhalde. Hani Yüzüklerin Efendisi yapısı gereği böyle çok ayrıntılı bir account vermiyor hani de. Yine aslında bayağı bir şey anlatıyor şöyle bir düşününce. Harry Potter'da bu olay bir şekilde baş karakter bir sürü zor şey yaşıyorken, bir sürü ondan anlayan insan varken bile çok az insan tam olarak böyle onunla tıpatıp aynı şeyi yaşadığını iddia edebiliyor falan. O insanlardan birisi burada çıktı falan. Harry böyle puf, şok hani direkt böyle. He hardly dared believe her, yet his heart was lightning almost in spite of himself falan. Hani bilmiyorum bir şekilde çok hisli şurası. Bir yandan şöyle kelime kelime bakınca çok fazla da bir şey söylemiyor ama Harry düpedüz aşık olacak Ginny'ye. Neden? Sadece güzel olmasından dolayı değil, aynı zamanda Ginny'nin onu anlayabilmesinden dolayı. Tamam mı? Düşün Abdullah. Neyse durum bu yani. Çok da diyecek bir şey yok şu an herhalde sanırım. Ama şey kaptınız. Burası kilit yer. Bundan sonra hani bundan sonra zaten hatta şey bile olmayacak. Ne bileyim. Harry Cho ile iyi anlaşmayacak falan bile. iyi olmayacak araları zaten hiçbir şekilde. Başladığı anlamda ilk buluştuğu andan itibaren böyle her şey kötüye gidecek falan. Sonra böyle bitecekler falan. Çünkü artık böyle cini süreci başladı gibi bir şey oldu şu an. Şu laftan sonra. Orası bayağı önemliymiş yani. Şurası. Resmen yetti böyle. Hani heriye stupid diyebildi. Burada bir kendini gerçekleştirme olayı da var biraz. Dur şuraya bir şey edeceğiz. Böyle deyince komik oluyor da o kadar değil. Böyle deyince komik oluyor ama... Değil mi? Feridun o kadar utanıyordu falan. Stupid diyebildi falan. Hani bir şekilde aslında Jin'in de kendi gerçekleştirme şeyi oluyor burası. Hani Harry asla söylemeyeceğini bildiği bir lafı söylüyor. Stupid. Harry böyle emin. Jin'i Harry hakaret etmeyecek insanlardan en başta falan geliyor. Çünkü cesaret edemez. Çünkü fazla utanıyor falan. O lafı etti. Bir de üstüne üstlük Harry'in asla söyleyemeyeceğini, kimsenin söyleyebileceğini ihtimal vermediğini düşündüğü bir fact'i, bir olayı, bir durumu, bir hissi cini birden söyleyebildi falan. Double motherfucker yani. Şu dört satır olayı bitiriyor. Aşırı ilgimi çekiyor burası. Çünkü benim de anlamaya çalıştığım şey bu benim. Bir şekilde hani bu sevgili olayları falan bir türlü olmadı. Olacağına da ihtimal vermiyor. Ama bak olayı görüyor musun? İhtimal vermediğim için aslında bir şekilde böyle geldiği zaman aşırı etkileniyor olacağım. Çünkü böyle referans kapılmış oluyor. Anlatabiliyor muyum? Hani birisi asla böyle söyleyebileceğini ihtimal vermediğim bir lafı söyleyebiliyor olacak bana falan. Ama böyle mi olacak? Anlatabiliyor muyum? Hani veya, ya da bir şekilde birisinin büyük bir fedakarlık yapıyor olması mı olacak? Ya da ne bileyim bir şekilde benim kendi cinsiyetim, karşımdaki insanın kendi cinsiyetini unutuşu mu olacak? Hani bu olay bu şekillerden birinde mi oluyor? Yoksa böyle yine bunlardan çok da farklı olmayan bir alternatif mi var bir şekilde? Hani bütün bu alternatifler genel olarak bunların adı aşk mı? Bunların adı başka bir şey mi falan? Bunlar böyle çok sadece hani önemli konular değil, aynı zamanda aşırı meraklı konular. Çünkü hani bunlar böyle şey değil ki ne bileyim sınavda iyi not almak için yaptığımız falan. Bunlar böyle bizim en doğal, en böyle bir şeyleri yapmak istediğimiz, bir şeylere sahip olmak istediğimiz dürtülerin şeyleri, questioning, onları böyle sorguluyoruz falan. Hani daha doğal, daha böyle daha hararetli bir şekilde isteyeceğimiz bir şey zaten yok hani. Hani böyle oturup düşünüyorum. Ben de durum nasıl olacak? Şimdi şu duvardaki resimleri görseniz var ya, o kadar böyle çok kafamdaki o insanın resmi var ki böyle. Nerede başlıyor? Nerede bitiyor? Anlatabiliyor muyum? Olacak mı? Aslında olmaması mı oluyor? Olması olmuyor mu falan? Ne yapacağım hiç bilmiyorum. Nasıl olacak hiç bilmiyorum. Hiçbir şey de yapmıyorum onun için. Resim çizmekten başka falan. Şu an çizdiğin resim bile öyle. Bunu göstermiştim ben. Aynen resmi de ilerlettim. Onu da göstereceğim iyi oluyor. Yani hem göstermem gereken resmi gösteriyorum hem de yine o. Yine o kişiyi. Ne oluyor? Yani anlatabiliyor muyum? Bu da biraz böyle dert videosu gibi oldu ama aslında tam öyle de değil. Aklım almıyor sonuç olarak. Düşün bakayım Abdullah bir şey geliyor mu aklına? It seems not. Devam ediyoruz ya. The dream I had about your dad and the snake, though. You had these dreams before, Hermione said. You had flashes of what Voldemort was up to last year. This was different, said Harry, shaking his head. I was inside that snake. It was like I was the snake. What if Voldemort somehow transported me to London? One day, said Hermione, sounding truly exasperated. You read Hogwarts, a history, and perhaps it will remind you that you can't operate or separate inside Hogwarts. Even Voldemort couldn't just make you fly out of your dormitory, Teddy. Voldemort couldn't just make, even Voldemort himself couldn't just make you fly out of your dormitory, Harry. Yani fly out yapamaz belki ama bir şekilde Voldemort uçabiliyordu falan. Hani bunda 7. kitapta bir şekilde öyle ya da böyle konuşacağız yanlış hatırlamıyorsam. Hani hızlı bir şekilde uçabilmiyor başarıyorsa 5 dakika diye elinin bir tahmini vardı. Aslında olmuş da olabiliyor falan gibi bir şey de var şimdi. Yalan yok hani. Bak ya kalem düşürmekten nefret ediyorum. Eğilip alamıyorum çünkü. Af. Bekleyin. Neyse ev cinleri var. Gayet de apparate ya da disapparate yapabiliyorlar. Inside Hogwarts falan. Hani bir ev cininin bir bağlantı olmadığını biliyoruz arada ya. İçeri böyle bu kadar net bir şekilde yılan olduğunu hissediyorken falan. Neyse. Diyecek bir şey var mı? Düşün Abdullah. Düşün. Devam. You didn't leave your bed, mate, said Ron. I saw you thrashing around in your sleep about a minute before we could wake you up. Bu da böyle bayağı güzel bir faktör Helen'in rahatlaması konusunda. Kaydı başlatıyorum ama başladım baş... Heh, işaret çıktı şimdi. Kaydı başlatıyorum ama başladım başlamadım mı şey olmuyor falan. İşaret bazen geç geliyor bazen hiç gelmiyor emin olamıyorum. Bu da bayağı güzel bir laf. Harry en azından şeyin garantisini alıyor şu an. Hani o rüyayı esnasında Harry kendi yatağında yatıyordu falan. Işına mı faktörü ortadan çıktı hala bir obskür yol tarzı bir şey olabilir, bir şeyler olabilir. Böyle bir astral seyahat böyle bir beynin bir yerlere gidip bir yerlerde zarar etmesi cercut böyle bir büyünün Harry'nin içindeki büyünün Harry'nin vücudundan kopup başka yerlere gitmesi falan gibi bir şey. Bu tarz possibility'lerden hala korkuyor, çekiniyor olacak Harry ama en azından kafasındaki birkaç possibility yakın arkadaşları dediği insanlar tarafından reddedilebildiği için Harry onların da o possibility'lerin de gerçekleşme ihtimalinden şüphelenirken onların böyle saf dışı olması bir şekilde arkadaşları sayesinde saf dışı olduğu için o possibility'ler arkadaşlarının yanında durmaya daha eğilimli olacak. Öte yandan görecek ki diğer possibility'leri de arkadaşları işte Harry, işte ne Harry'si, Ron, Hermione, Ginny falan onlar da diğer possibility'lerden bahsetmiyor olacaklar falan. Harry böyle düzelme sürecine girecek. Hiç olmadı diyelim. Güzel. Harry started pacing up and down the room again, thinking. What they were all saying was not only comforting, it made sense. Without really thinking, he took a sandwich from the plate on the bed and crammed it hungrily into his mouth. I'm not the weapon after all, thought Harry. His heart swelled with happiness and relief, and he felt like joining in as they heard Sirius tramping past their door toward Buckbeak's room, singing, God rest you, merry Hippogriff. Hippogriff at the top of his voice. How could he have dreamed of returning to Privet Drive for Christmas? Sirius's delight at having the house full again, and especially at having Harry back, was infectious. He was no longer their sullen host of the summer. Now he seemed determined that everyone should enjoy themselves as much, if not more, than they would have done at Hogwarts. And he worked tirelessly in the run-up to Christmas Day, cleaning and decorating with their help, so that by the time they all went to bed on Christmas Eve, the house was barely recognizable. Revidarkijem. How could he have dreamed of returning to Privet Drive for Christmas? Sirius's delight at having the house full again, and especially at having Harry back, was infectious. He was no longer their sullen host of the summer. Now he seemed determined that everyone should enjoy themselves as much, if not more, than they would have done at Hogwarts. And he worked tirelessly in the run-up to Christmas Day, the cleaning and decorating with their help, so that by the time they all went to bed on Christmas Eve, the house was barely recognizable. The tarnished chandeliers were no longer hung with cobwebs, but with garlands of holly and gold and silver streamers. Magical snow glittered in heaps over the threadbare carpets. A great Christmas tree, obtained by Mundungus and decorated with live fairies, blocked Sirius's family tree from view, and even the stuffed elf heads on the hall Father, Christmas Hats and Beards. Here he awoke on Christmas morning to find a stack of presents at the foot of his bed and Ron already halfway through opening his own rather larger pile. Good haul this year, he informed Harry through a cloud of paper. Thanks for the broom, compass, its excellent beads, harmonies. She's got me a homework planner. Thanks for the broom, compass, it's excellent diyor. Bir dakika. Ron Harry'ye beads, harmonies, harmonikini dövüyor diyor. Harmonikinden daha iyi diyor. She's got me a homework planner. He sorted through his presents and found one with Hermione's handwriting on it. She had given him two a book that resembled a diary, except it said things like, "Do it today or later you'll pay," every time he opened the page. Sirius and Lupin had given Harry a set of excellent books entitled Practice of Defensive Magic and Its Use Against the Dark Arts, which had superb Sirius ve Lupin beraber yollamışlar. Which had superb moving color illustrations of all the counter Jacksons and hexes it described. Lupin de gayet farkında ve hiçbir şey demedi ama Harry'i desteklediğini anlıyoruz. Sirius'a beraber kitabı vermesinden çünkü Sirius'u direkt açık açık desteklediğini biliyoruz zaten Dumbledore'un ordusunu. Öyle. Harry flicked through the first volume eagerly. He could see it was going to be highly useful in his plans for the DA. Forty nokta şu nokta aynı zamanda şeyin noktası demek ki bölüm bitişinin. Demek ki böyle kullanıyormuş. Ben iki tane nokta koyuyordum peş peşe falan. Sen kendi eserlerine böyle bir bitirme, cümleyi böyle bir bitiriş olması gerektiği zaman falan. Öyle tek nokta yetiyormuş. Hagrid had sent a furry brown wallet that had fangs, which were presumably supposed to be an anti-theft device. But unfortunately prevented Harry putting any money in without getting his fingers ripped off. Tonks's present was a small working model of a firebolt, which Harry wore to fly around the room, wishing he still had his full-size version. Ron had given him an enormous box of every flavor beans. Mr. and Mrs. Weasley, the usual hand-knitted jumper and some mince pies, and Dobby a truly dreadful painting that Harry suspected had been done by the elf himself. He had just turned it upside down to see whether it looked better that way when, with a loud crack, Fred and George apparated at the foot of his bed. "Merry Christmas," said George. "Don't go downstairs for a bit." "Why not?" said Mom. "Mom's crying again," said Fred heavily. Percy sent back his Christmas jumper. "Without a note," added George. "Hasn't asked how Dad is or visited him or visited him or anything." "We tried to comfort her," said Fred, moving around the bed to look at Harry's portrait. "Told her Percy is nothing more than a homunculus pile of red droppings." "Didn't work," said George, helping himself to a chocolate frog. So Lupin took over. "Best let him cheer her up before we go down for breakfast, I reckon." "Was that supposed to be anyway?" asked Fred, squinting at Dobby's painting. "Looks like a gibbon with two black eyes." "It's Harry," said George, pointing at the back of the picture. "Say so on the back." "Good likeness," said Fred, grinning. He retrieved his new homework diary at him. It hit the wall opposite and fell to the floor where it sat happily. "If you've dotted the i's and crossed the t's, then you may do whatever you please." Ve de yazım şeyleri de veriyor. Şey, diary. Tavsiyesi. "They got up and dressed. They could hear various inhabitants of the house calling Merry Christmas to each other. On their way downstairs, they met Hermione. "Thanks for the book, Harry," she said happily. "I've been wanting that new theory of numerology for ages. And that perfume is really unusual." Ron, ettiği bir ünlem yok. Ron parfüm almış. Hermione, bence bu bir şey. Bir işaret bu. Öyle hani ne derler? Düşün Abdullah. İlk adım. Ron bunun bir ilk adım olduğunu düşünüyor. Hermione belki düşünse bunun bir ilk adım olduğunu anlıyordur falan. Ron tarafından Hermione'ye karşı atılmış. Ama bu ilk adımı beğenmiyor. Onun için sevinmiyor. And that parfume is really unusual, Ron falan. "No problem," said Ron. "Who's that for anyway?" he added, nodding at the neatly wrapped present she was carrying. Öyle Ron da adımlar atıyor kendince falan ama bayağı kötü bir durumda olduğumuz için hem Ron hem ben falan kendi adımıza Adımlar da pek bir işe yaramıyor açıkçası. İçin devam mı desek? Ama birazcık düşünelim. Belki önemli bir şey gelir aklımıza. Bu konular benim için çok önemli biliyorsunuz. Ay ay ay düşün. Devam da. Creatures at harmony, brightly. It had better not be close, it drawn warningly. You know what Sirius said. Creature knows too much, we can't set him free. It isn't close at harmony. Although if I had my way, I'd certainly give him something to wear other than that filthy old rag. It had better not be close, said Ron warningly. You know what Sirius said? Creature knows too much, we can't set him free. It isn't close at harmony. Although if I had my way, I'd certainly give him something to wear other than that filthy old rag. No, it's a patchwork quilt. I thought it would brighten up his bedroom. What bedroom, said Harry, dropping his voice to a whisper as they were passing the portrait of Sirius's mother. Well, Sirius says it's not so much a bedroom, more a kind of den, said Hermione. Apparently sleeps under the boiler in that cupboard of the kitchen. Mrs. Weasley was the only person in the basement when they arrived there. She was standing at the stove and sounded as though she had a bad head cold when she wished them Merry Christmas, and they all averted their eyes. Mrs. Weasley was the only person in the basement when they arrived there. She was standing at the store and sounded as though she had a bad head cold when she wished them Merry Christmas and they all averted their eyes. Ne oldu tam anlamadım. So this is creature's bedroom, said Ron, strolling over to a dingy door in the corner opposite the pantry which Harry had never seen open. Yes, said Hermione, now sounding a little nervous. I think we'd better knock. Ron rapped the door with his knuckles, but there was no reply. He must be sneaking around upstairs, he said, and without further ado pulled open the door. Ooh, at the... He peered inside. Most of the cupboard was taken up with a very large and old-fashioned boiler, but in the foot space underneath the pipes, creature had made themselves something that looked like a nest. A jumble of assorted rags and smelly old blankets were piled on the floor, and a small dent in the middle of it showed where creature curled up to sleep every night. Here and there among the material were stale bread crusts and moldy old bits of cheese. In a far corner glinted small objects and coins that Harry guessed creature had saved magpie-like from Sirius's purge of the house, and he had also managed to retrieve the silver framed family photographs that Sirius had thrown away over the summer. Their glass might be shattered, but still the little black and white people inside them peered haughtily up at him, including, he felt a little jolt in his stomach, the dark, evil little woman whose trial he had witnessed in Dumbledore's pensieve, Bellatrix Lestrange. By the looks of it, hers was creature's favorite photograph. He had placed it to the fore of all the others and had mended the glass clumsily with speller tape. I think I'll just leave his present here, said Hermione, laying the package neatly in the middle of the depression in the rags and blankets and closing the door quietly. He'll find it later, it'll be fine. Come to think of it, said Sirius, emerging from the pantry carrying a large turkey as they closed the cupboard door. Has anyone actually seen creature lately? I haven't seen him since the night we came back here, said Harry. We were ordering him out of the kitchen. Yes, said Sirius firmly. You know, I think that's the last time I saw him too. He must be hiding upstairs somewhere. He couldn't have left, could he, said Harry. I mean, when you said out, maybe he thought you meant get out of the house. No, no, house elves can't leave unless they're given clothes. They're tied to their family's house, said Sirius. They can leave the house if they really want to, Harry contradicted them. Dobby did. He left the Malfoy's to give me warnings 2 years ago. Az da çok belli şu an. Doğru bir okuyucu, ben zamanında doğru bir okuyucu değildim itiraf ediyorum. Doğru bir okuyucu, iyi bir okuyucu direkt burada bir bokluk olduğunu, işin direkt creature'dan patlayacağını anlar yani. Açık ve net. He had to punish himself afterward, but he still managed it. Sirius looked slightly disconcerted for a moment, then said, "I'll look for him later. I expect I'll find him upstairs crying his eyes out over my mother's old bloomers or something. Of course, he might have crawled into the aiding cupboard and died, but I mustn't get my hopes up." Fred, George, and Ron laughed. Hermione, however, looked reproachful. Once they had had their Christmas lunch, the Weasleys and Harry and Hermione were planning to pay Mr. Weasley another visit, escorted by Mad-Eye and Lupin. Mundungus turned up in time for Christmas pudding, and Trifle, having managed to borrow a car for the occasion, is underground and not run on Christmas Day. The car, which Harry doubted very much had been taken with the knowledge or consent of its owner, had a similar enlarging spell put upon it as the Weasleys' old Ford Anglia. Although normally proportioned outside, 10 people with Mundungus driving were able to fit into it quite comfortably. Mrs. Weasley hesitated at the point of getting inside. He knew that her disapproval of Mundungus was battling with her dislike of traveling without magic. Finally, the cold outside and her children's pleading triumphed, and she settled herself into the back seat between Fred and Bill with good grace. The journey to Setemungos was quite quick, as there was very little traffic on the roads. A small trickle of witches and wizards were creeping furtively up the otherwise deserted street to visit the hospital. Ya şimdi burada manipüle olmuş bir insanın laflarını etmek istemiyorum. Bu Christmas olayları falan apaşırı cezbediyor beni. Yani bir şekilde kabul, direkt filmlerden öğrendik kabul. Direkt it gibi Amerikan kültürü üstünde başarılı olduğu zamanında falan ama oğlum şu atmosfer falan harika ya. Şöyle bir Christmas geçirsen falan var ya çok sarardı yani. Gözlerim açık gitmezdi demiyorum ama gözlerim açık cidden gitmezdi yani. Yalan yok, tamam mı? Bir gün inşallah belki olur. Şöyle bir Christmas atmosfer, şöyle bir Christmas ne bileyim o kırmızı beyazlı bir yerlerde bir evde olma böyle bir o tarz şey işte Gothic Salon gibi falan orada da tam öyle bir atmosfer olacak. Hani yedinci kitap, yedinci kitap kalbim acıyor falan. Oh yeah. Çok iyi, çok iyi olaylar var daha okuyacağımız. Harry Potter'ları iyi ya. Vallahi iyi bak. Tamam şurada bir durayım. Diyecek bir şey yok. Devam. Harry and the others got out of the car and Mundungus drove off around the corner to wait for them. They strolled casually toward the window where the dummy in green nylon stood. Then one by one stepped through the glass. Ahem etmeye başladım. Öksürürken bunu kendine atacağım. Tamam mı? The reception area looked pleasantly festive. The crystal orbs that illuminated Setemungos had been turned to red and gold so that they became gigantic, glowing Christmas baubles. Holly hung around every doorway and shining white Christmas trees covered in magical snow and icicles glittered in every corner, each topped with a gleaming gold star. It was less crowded than the last time they had been there. Although halfway across the room, Harry found himself shunted aside by a witch with a walnut jammed up her left nostril. Family argument, huh? Smirked the blonde witch behind the desk. You're the third I've seen today. Spell damage, fourth floor. They found Mr. Weasley propped up in bed with the remains of his turkey dinner on a tray in his lap. And a rather sheepish expression on his face. Everything all right, Arthur asked Mrs. Weasley after they had all greeted Mr. Weasley and handed over their presents. Fine, fine, said Mr. Weasley, a little too heartily. You haven't seen Healer Smatchwick, have you? No, said Mrs. Weasley suspiciously. Why? Nothing, nothing, said Mr. Weasley, eagerly, starting to unwrap his pile of gifts. Well, everyone had a good day. What did you all get for Christmas? Oh, Harry, this is absolutely wonderful. For he had just opened Harry's gift of fused wire and screwdrivers. Mrs. Weasley did not seem entirely satisfied with Mr. Weasley's answer. As her husband leaned over to shake Harry's hand, she peered at the bandaging under his nightshirt. Arthur, she said, with a snap in her voice like a mouse trap, you had your bandages changed. Why have you had your bandages changed a day early? Arthur, they told me they wouldn't need doing until tomorrow. What, said Mr. Weasley, looking rather frightened and pulling the bed covers higher up his chest. No, it's nothing. He seemed to deflate under Mrs. Weasley's piercing gaze. Well, now don't get upset, Molly, but Augustus Pye had an idea. He's the trainee healer, trainee ya da iki e nasıl okunuyor hala emin değilim. You know, lovely young çeben, very interested in complementary medicine. I mean, some of these old muggle remedies, well, they're called stitches, Molly, dikiş. And they work very well on muggle bones. Mrs. Weasley let out an ominous noise somewhere between a shriek and a snarl. Lupin strolled away from the bed and over to the werewolf, who had no visitors and was looking rather wistfully at the crowd around Mr. Weasley. Bill muttered something about getting himself a cup of tea, and Fred and George leapt up to accompany him, grinning. Bir dakika. Lupin strolled away from the bed and over to the werewolf, who had no visitors and was looking rather wistfully at the crowd around Mr. Weasley. İyi, Lupin gidip adamla konuşuyormuş. Ne konuştuğunu duymasak bile bu bile gayet iyi hissettiriyor bizi yani. Şaka falan değil. Do you mean to tell me, said Mrs. Weasley, her voice growing louder with every word, and apparently unaware that her fellow visitors were scurrying for cover, that you have been messing about with muggle remedies? Not messing about, Molly, dear, said Mr. Weasley imploringly. It was just something Pye and I thought we'd try. Only most unfortunately, well, with these particular kinds of wounds, it doesn't seem to work as well as we'd hoped. Meaning, well, I don't know whether you know what stitches are. It sounds as though you've been trying to sew your skin back together, said Mrs. Weasley with a snort of mirthless laughter. But even you, Arthur, wouldn't be that stupid. I fancy a cup of tea too, said Harry, jumping to his feet. Hermione, Ron and Ginny almost sprinted to the door with him. As it swung closed behind them, they heard Mrs. Weasley cry, "What do you mean? That's the general idea." "Typical," that said Ginny, shaking her head as they set off up the corridor. "Stitches, I ask you." "Well, you know, they do work well on non-magical ones," said Hermione fairly. "I suppose something in the snake's venom dissolves them or something. I wonder where the tear room is." "Fifth floor," said Harry, remembering the sign over the welcome witch's desk. They walked along the corridor through a set of double doors and found a rickety staircase lined with more portraits of brutal-looking healers. As they climbed it, the various healers called out to them, diagnosing odd complaints and suggesting horrible remedies. Ron was seriously affronted when a medieval wizard called out that he clearly had a bad case of spettergroid. "And what's that supposed to be?" he asked angrily as the healer pursued him through six more portraits, shoving the occupants out of the way. Hani hiç hatırlamıyorum buraları. "'Tis the most grievous affliction of the skin, young master, that will leave you pockmarked and more gruesome even than you are now." "Watch who you're calling gruesome," said Ron, his ears turning red. "The only remedy is to take the liver of a toad, bend it, bind it tight about your throat, stand naked by the full moon in a barrel of eels' eyes. I have not got spettergroid, but unsightly blemishes upon your visage, young master." "Do freckles," said Ron furiously. "Now get back in your own picture and leave me alone." He rounded on the others, who were all keeping determinedly straight faces. "What floor is this?" "I think it's the fifth," said Hermione. "No, it's the fourth," said Harry. "One more." But as he stepped onto the landing, he came to an abrupt halt, staring at the small windows set into the double doors that marked the start of a corridor, signposted spell damage. A man was peering out at them all with his nose pressed against the glass. He had wavy blonde hair, bright blue eyes, and a broad, vacant smile that revealed dazzlingly white teeth. "Blimey," said Ron, also staring at the man. "Oh my goodness," said Hermione suddenly, sounding breathless. "Professor Lockhart." Their ex-defense against the dark arts teacher pushed open the doors and moved toward them, wearing a long lilac dressing gown. "Lilac, lilac," diyeceğim. "Well, hello there," he said. "I expect you'd like my autograph, would you?" "Hasn't changed much, has he?" Harry muttered to Ginny, who grinned. How are you, professor? Said Ron, sounding slightly guilty. It had been Ron's malfunctioning wand that had damaged Professor Lockhart's memory so badly that he had landed here in the first place. Though, as Lockhart had been attempting to permanently wipe Harry and Ron's memories at the time, Harry's sympathy was limited. I'm very well indeed, thank you, said Lockhart exuberantly, pulling a rather battered peacock feather quill from his pocket. Now, how many autographs would you like? I can do joined up writing now, you know. We don't want any at the moment, thanks, said Ron, raising his eyebrows at Harry. Şöyle, who asked, Professor, should you be wandering around the corridors? Shouldn't you be in a ward? The smile faded slowly from Lockhart's face. For a few moments, he gazed intently at Harry, then he said, haven't we met? Yeah, we have, said Harry. You used to teach us at Hogwarts, remember? The smile faded slowly from Lockhart's face. For a few moments, he gazed intently at Harry, then he said, haven't we met? Biz tanışmamış mıydık? Bu var deyince acaba hemşirelerden biri falan mı geldi aklına da böyle bir laf ediyor? Merakımı cezbetmedi değil ama bulmamın imkanı yok. Devam de. Teach, repeated Lockhart, looking faintly unsettled. Me? Did I? Did I falan. Ama tabii Mr. Weasley did I değil bu. Did I falan. And then the smile reappeared upon his face so suddenly it was rather alarming. Taught you everything you know I expect, did I? Well, how about those autographs then? Shall we say around dozen? We can give them to all your little friends then and nobody will be left out. But just then a head poked out of a door at the far end of the corridor and a voice said, Gilderoy, you naughty boy, where have you wandered off to? A motherly looking healer wearing a tinsel wreath in her hair came bustling up the corridor, smiling warmly at Harry and the others. Oh, Gilderoy, you got visitors. How lovely. And on Christmas Day, too. Do you know he never gets visitors, poor lamb. And I can't think why he's such a sweetie, aren't you? You're doing autographs, Gilderoy told the healer with another glittering smile. There were lots of them. Won't take no for an answer. I just hope you've got enough photographs. Listen to him, said the healer, taking Lockhart's arm and beaming fondly at him as though he were a precocious two-year-old. He was rather well known a few years ago. He very much hoped that this liking for giving autographs is a sign that his memory might be coming back a little bit. Will you step this way? He's in a closed ward, you know. He must have slipped out while I was bringing in the Christmas presents. The door is usually kept locked. Not that he's dangerous, but she lowered her voice to a whisper. Bit of a danger to himself, bless him. Doesn't know who he is, you see. Wanders off and can't remember how to get back. It is nice of you to have come to see him, said Ron, gesturing uselessly at the floor above. Actually, we were just, But the healer was smiling expectantly at them, and Ron's feeble mutter of going to have a cup of tea trailed away into nothingness. They looked at one another rather hopelessly and then followed Lockhart and his healer along the corridor. Let's not stay long, Ron said quietly. The healer pointed her wand at the door of the Janus Tiki ward and muttered, Alohomora. The door swung open and she led the way inside, keeping a firm grasp on Gilderoy's arm until she had settled him into an armchair beside his bed. This is our long-term resident ward, she informed Harry, Ron, Hermione, and Ginny in a low voice. For permanent spell damage, you know. Of course, with intensive remedial potions and charms and a bit of luck, we can produce some improvement. Gilderoy does seem to be getting back some sense of himself, and we've seen a real improvement in Mr. Bott. He seems to be regaining the power of speech very well, though he isn't speaking any language we recognize yet. Well, I must finish giving out the Christmas presents and leave you all to chat. He looked around. This ward bore unmistakable signs of being a permanent home to its residents. They had many more personal effects around their beds than in Mr. Weasley's ward. The wall around Gilderoy's headboard, for instance, was papered with pictures of himself, all beaming totally and waving at the new arrivals. He had autographed many of them to himself in disjointed, childish writing. The moment he had been deposited in his chair by the healer, Gilderoy pulled a fresh stack of photographs toward him, seized a quill, and started signing them all feverishly. "You can put them in envelopes," he said to Ginny, throwing the signed pictures into her lap one by one as he finished them. "I'm not forgotten, you know. No, I still receive a very great deal of fan mail. Gladys Gajin writes weekly. I just wish I knew why." He paused, looking faintly puzzled, then beamed again and returned to his signing with renewed vigor. "I suspect it is simply my good looks." A sallow-skinned, mournful-looking wizard lay in the bed opposite, staring at the ceiling. He was mumbling to himself and seemed quite unaware of anything around him. Two beds along was a woman whose entire head was covered in fur. He remembered something similar happening to Hermione during their second year, although fortunately the damage in her case had not been permanent. At the far end of the ward, flowery curtains had been drawn around two beds to give the occupants and their visitors some privacy. "Here you are, Agnes," said the healer brightly to the furry-faced woman, handing her a small pile of Christmas presents. "See, not forgotten, are you? And your son sent an owl to say he is visiting tonight, so that's nice, isn't it?" Agnes gave several loud barks. "And look, Broderick, you've been sent a potted plant and a lovely calendar with a different fancy hippogriff for each month. They brighten things up, won't they?" said the healer, bustling along to the mumbling man, setting a rather ugly plant with long, swaying tentacles on the bedside cabinet and fixing the calendar to the wall with her wand. "I know, Mrs. Longbottom, are you leaving already?" Bizimkiler şok burada. He said, "Spin around, spin around." The curtains had been drawn back from the two beds at the end of the ward, and two visitors were walking back down the aisle between the beds. Aisle, diyeceğim de dedim burada. Aisle, izle olunca aisle, aisle olunca, gerçi izle olunca yine aisle olmuş oluyor. Aisle, aisle diyeceğim. Between the beds, a formidable looking old witch wearing a long green dress, a moth-eaten fox fur, and a pointed head decorated with what was unmistakably a stuffed vulture, and trailing behind her, looking truly depressed. "Neville!" With a sudden rush of understanding, Harry realized who the people in the ant beds must be. He cast around wildly for some means of distracting the others so that Neville could leave the ward unnoticed and unquestioned. But Ron had looked up at the sound of the name Longbottom too, and before Harry could stop him, had called, "Neville!" Neville jumped and covered as though a bullet had not only missed him. Böyle şey etmiş, saklanmış onun herhalde. "It's us," Neville said, Ron brightly, getting to his feet. "Have you seen? Lockhart's here. Who have you been visiting? Friends of yours, Neville, dear," said Neville's grandmother graciously, bearing down upon them all. Neville looked as though he would rather be anywhere in the world but here. A dull purple flush was creeping up his plump face, and he was not making eye contact with any of them. "Ah, yes," said his grandmother, looking closely at Harry and sticking out a shriveled claw-like hand for him to shake. Yes, I know who you are, of course. Neville speaks most highly of you." Thanks," said Harry, shaking hands. Neville did not look at him, but stared at his own feet, the color deepening in his face all the while. "And you too are clearly Weasleys," Mrs. Longbottom continued, proffering her hand regally to Ron and Ginny in turn. "Yes, I know your parents. Not well, of course, but fine people, and you must be Hermione Granger." Hermione looked rather startled that Mrs. Longbottom knew her name, but shook hands all the same. "Yes, Neville's told me all about you. Helped him out of a few sticky spots, haven't you? He's a good boy," she said, casting a sternly appraising look down her rather bony nose at Neville. "But he hasn't got his father's talent, I'm afraid to say," and she jerked her head in the direction of the two beds at the end of the ward, so that the stuffed vulture on her head trembled alarmingly. "What?" said Ron, looking amazed. He wanted to stamp on Ron's foot, but that sort of thing was much harder to bring off unnoticed when you were wearing jeans rather than robes. "Is it your dad down the end, Neville?" "What's this?" said Mrs. Longbottom sharply. "Haven't you told your friends about your parents, Neville?" Neville took a deep breath, looked up at the ceiling, and shook his head. He could not remember ever feeling sorry for anyone, but he could not think of any way of helping Neville out of the situation. "Well, it's nothing to be ashamed of," said Mrs. Longbottom angrily. "You should be proud, Neville, proud. They didn't give their health and their sanity, so their only son would be ashamed of them, you know." "I'm not ashamed," said Neville very faintly. "Not ashamed." Still looking anywhere but at Harry and the others, Ron was now standing on tiptoe to look over at the inhabitants of the two beds. "Well, you've got a funny way of showing it," said Mrs. Longbottom. "My son and his wife," she said, turning heartily to Harry, Ron, Hermione, and Ginny, "were tortured into insanity by you-know-who's followers." Hermione and Ginny both clapped their hands over their mouths. Ron stopped craning his neck to catch a glimpse of Neville's parents and looked mortified. "They were orders, you know, and very well respected within the wizarding community," Mrs. Longbottom went on. "Highly gifted, the pair of them. Yes, Alice dear, what is it?" Neville's mother had come edging down the ward in her night dress. She no longer had the plump, happy-looking face he had seen in Moody's old photograph of the original Order of the Phoenix. Her face was thin and worn now. Her eyes seemed overlarge, and her hair, which had turned white, was wispy and dead-looking. She did not seem to want to speak, or perhaps she was not able to, but she made timid motions toward Neville, holding something in her outstretched hand. "Again," said Mrs. Longbottom, sounding slightly weary. "Very well, Alice dear, very well. Neville, take it, whatever it is." But Neville had already stretched out his hand, into which his mother dropped an empty Drupal's blowing gum wrapper. "Very nice, dear," said Neville's grandmother in a falsy, cheery voice, patting his mother on the shoulder. But Neville said quietly, "Thanks, Mom." His mother tottered away, back up the ward, humming to herself. Neville looked around at the others, his expression defiant, as though daring them to laugh. But Harry did not think he'd ever found anything less funny in his life. "Well, we'd better get back," sighed Mrs. Longbottom, drawing on long green gloves. "Very nice to have met you all. Neville, put that wrapper in the bin. She must have given enough of them to paper your bedroom by now." But as they left, Harry was sure he saw Neville slip the wrapper into his pocket. The door closed behind them. "I never knew," said Hermione, who looked tearful. "Nor did I," said Ron rather hoarsely. "Nor me," whispered Ginny. They all looked at Harry. "I did," he said glumly. "Dumbledore told me, but I promise I wouldn't mention it. That's what Bellatrix Lestrange got sent to Azkaban for, using the Cruciatus curse on Neville's parents until they lost their minds." "Bellatrix Lestrange did that," whispered Hermione horrified. "That woman creature's got a photo of in his den." There was a long silence, broken by Lockhart's angry voice. "Look, I didn't learn joined-up writing for nothing, you know." "Look, I didn't learn joined-up writing for nothing, you know." Bu foto deyince büyük ihtimal Lockhart ona laf attı. "Look, I didn't learn joined up writing for nothing. You know, alias'ını boşuna öğrenmedim." Diyor. Peki diyoruz. Peki diyoruz. Chapter 24. Occlumency. Bu Sirius, bu da Snape büyük ihtimal. Snape'in tipi de benziyor. Az buçuk filmdeki halini. Diyecek bir şey var mı? Yine üzücü bir bölüm okuduk. Daha üzücü bölümler okuyacağız mı? Yani üzücü bölümler okuyacağız bayağı bir. Dahasını bilmiyorum da. Diyecek bir şey yok. Hadi görüşürüz ben.